Good morning, everyone, and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. It popped up about 10 to 15 minutes ago, so just missed it. But isn't it a beautiful way to start the morning? Clear skies here at Juma. It's already about 25 degrees Celsius, which is around 77 degrees Fahrenheit, and we are looking forward to a great adventure with all of you guys this morning. I'm going to start driving without wasting too much time, because we've thankfully got an update from four of you guys, Siberia, Kevin, Lucy, and Cam. And they updated us either via email or Twitter, so if any of you are joining for the first time, we can communicate with one another. And they would have hashtagged Safari Live on Twitter or sent an email through to questions@wildearth.tv. And it's a great way for us to interact on this live safari. And the update that they gave us was off the Juma waterhole camera, which runs 24 hours a day. And there were two lioness seen drinking at a small little pond there. And in all likelihood, those are the same two lioness that Jamie's been spending a lot of time with. And they've been busy feeding on a buffalo not too far from there. So let's go and see if we can find them. They've either taken a break nearby, that waterhole, or they've made their way back to the buffalo carcass, which will be interesting to see, because I know it was quite rotting, full of maggots last night. Now, my name is Scott, if you are joining for the first time, and I'm teamed up with Andrew on camera today. And Jamie has headed out on the other vehicle with Viam on camera. So you'll be getting to meet her a little bit later. And Jess is directing the show in the final control room, with Nikki lending her a hand. There's also a good chance we're going to have the eagle view today with the drone. And the cameramen are certainly loving their new challenge of having to master that skill. It's obviously very different to filming on the camera with on the back of the vehicle. And I think it's providing us all with some great views of Juma that really have never been seen before until this drone came into the picture. And we're going to have a lot more fun in the coming weeks and months with it. So that's something to look forward to a little bit later on. Got some more great news through, and it's also on the Juma Dam cam, and that is that those two lioness have in fact not moved back to the buffalo kill, and they are still close to that little pond where they quenched their thirst at around 5:30 this morning, is the time that they were seen drinking. And I think it was about 3 days ago that the Juma Dam cam, and again with your guys' help and support, provided us with the information saying that there was two vehicles parked at the waterhole, and nobody was too sure what was going on there, so Jamie rushed over and found some of the guides with that lioness there. At least one of the lioness, and she led Jamie back to the buffalo carcass to the second lioness. So it does provide us with a lot of useful information. Sometimes it can be a little bit frustrating. We get a report that an animal has been seen at the dam, and we rush over there, and only a minute or two after it's disappeared out of view, we arrive and still can't manage to find it. Which doesn't make us look too clever, but it certainly is a wonderful addition to our team and helping to get us into sightings. Where the rest of the Inkahuma pride are, and these two lioness are from the Inkahuma pride. They should be another four members running around somewhere, but we've been chatting with the other guides and nobody's seen them for quite some time. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we got to see them reunite in the coming days? It certainly is possible. Another group of lion that would be wonderful to see are the Birmingham Coalition, who probably play a large role in the reason why the Inkahuba Pride have split up. It's a young coalition who have come marauding through this area, hoping to establish this territory as their own. And they were seen not too far from here yesterday. They had made a small buffalo kill 2 nights ago. And maybe they finished that yesterday evening and continued north towards Juma from where they are. So we are going to go and check our southern boundary a little bit later on for any sign of them. Minutes away from where these lions should be, so don't go anywhere if you did have any plans and you would like to see some lion. There's little birds that we could hear chirping away. They were just on our left hand side with rattling cisticolas, and I just had a look to make sure there was no leopard beneath them. They can be good indicators of leopards being around, letting off their shrill alarm call. But being such small birds, they alarm for just about any small predator up to the size of leopards. So at this time of the year, they can often lead you on a bit of a wild predator chase. And it's something that is probably going to happen, and you guys are going to get to see us racing in to the sites of alarm calls from the various animals that let off alarm calls on their neighborhood watch security system. But now that it's summer, there's going to be a lot of snakes moving around, and a lot of the animals that we hear alarm calling will be alarm calling at the snakes, which are often very, very difficult to see because they tend to avoid us and slither into cover before we can get close enough to see them. As you can hear, is an Egyptian goose flying off. And I just stopped to see if we could get a shot of it for you, but it flew off just before that opportunity was. Needs to scan carefully now. I know the Juma Dam here. Oh, they are awesome. This is interesting. The family of the Nyala in the background and the lodge. As Andrew zooms in, you'll see the lioness hiding behind a small little pond where they were drinking, in a perfect ambush position. And that's the beautiful Vuyatela camp. It's one of the two camps here at Juma. It's Vuyatela and Galago. And I wonder if these Inyala are planning on coming for a drink. We could be in for some action here. I'm not sure where the other lioness is. I can't see her from this position. And as I said earlier, they are extremely full-bellied, these two lioness. So despite this, they will still try and catch and kill whatever opportunities are presented to them. Oh, look at her crouching down. Oh, they just got a fright as that Franklin took off. And look at how the lioness has flattened herself to the ground. This is awesome. What a great start to the morning. I'm told the lioness is a little bit further back and to the left of where this lioness is lying. For now, though, it looks like these Inyala are going to coast straight past the lion. Not heading towards this waterhole. Well, if I thought that there was going to be a chase, I would probably stay here, but I don't think that is going to be the case. So I'm just going to reposition the vehicle quickly and try and get us some better views. I said these lions are highly opportunistic, like most predators, and they'd be happy to substitute their old rotting buffalo carcass with some fresh Inyala. Interesting to see if they actually return to that buffalo kill. There'll come a point in time where it is simply too rotten to feed on. But for those of you who were on the Sunset Safari, lions and most predators are happy to gorge themselves on maggot-ridden flesh. The Inyala have moved off a safe distance and they're heading straight towards the final control room where Nikki and Jess are sitting up to our left. What I want to do is try and get on the complete opposite side of these lions to get an idea of the view that the Inyala would have of them. One's lying out completely in the open, so that would have blown any potential chances of catching these Inyala if they did come for a drink. But the one on the left certainly did have itself in a perfect spot. Look at her ears reflecting in the water there. Beautiful. Unlike cheetah and wild dog, which are two predators that we sadly don't get to see very often, both lion and leopard need to be incredibly close to their prey before they start their chase. And that's why some of you may be wondering, why haven't they run after these Inyala? They weren't that far away, but probably still five times further than the lion's ambush distance. 10 to 15 meters is the ideal distance in which to start their ambush. Obviously, if there were more lion around and they managed to encompass their prey, it makes things a little bit different. But for a solitary hunter like a leopard, 5 to 10 meters is the maximum distance that they will usually start chasing from. And what a beautiful scene this is here at the Juma Water. And again, a big thank you to Siberia, Kevin, Lucy and Cam for their updates on these lion. The dam cam is that little white blob above the lioness in a tambuti tree. So that's where all of the action comes from on the Juma cam. Give it a friendly wave. There is a strong chance that it's on us. Andrew's very busy focusing, but there we go. He's managed to put a squeeze in a little wave. I did mention that they are highly opportunistic, and if the opportunity presented itself, they would have tried to catch one of these in Yala. But Cheryl sent through a tweet saying that she thinks they were too full to try and chase these in Yala. And yes, certainly Cheryl, their lack of hunger would make them slightly less determined to catch prey. But it is important to remember that given a good opportunity, regardless of how full-bellied they are, they will always try and catch more food. The Birmingham Coalition that I spoke about earlier were actually probably just a month or two away from us now last year, so it would have been November or December last year, where they were actually busy feeding on a buffalo carcass, literally chewing on it, and had been for about 24 hours. They'd caught it the night before, and this was an afternoon drive when this all unfolded. And another herd of buffalo came onto the scene, and they abandoned the kill that they were currently actually feeding on and went and caught another buffalo, a youngster. And they were very full-bellied, yet they took that opportunity and made the most of it. So that's a good example of how lions that are even currently feeding on a kill will still be inclined to try and acquire more food. And the same goes for leopard. I've seen leopard with two different kills hoisted in separate trees, quite close to one another. And the reason for this is that it is very difficult for them to catch their prey. Most predators only succeed 10 to 20% of the times they try and catch their food. And they know this and will therefore make the most of whatever opportunity presents itself. They're still looking off in the distance of the, in the direction of the Nyala, and we can swivel across to show them to you. They're currently feeding with not a worry in the world and have no idea that these lion are watching them. Well, what a beautiful morning it is, and I'm not too sure how long to actually spend with these lion. They are in quite a good ambush position, and if anything else does come to drink, some action could unfold. But maybe we should rely on the Juma cam to keep us updated on their movements, and we can head off in search of some other action. I'll leave it up to you though. Let me know your thoughts, and to do that, again, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or send an email through to questions@wildearth.tv, and you can decide what we do next. But I don't feel confident that we are gonna get too much action or excitement out of these ladies. As I said that, I am proved wrong. We may get a nice head buzzle here, or possibly some more drinking. Look at how wonderful that silhouette is. Awesome. Well, aren't they lucky that it's a dead still morning in terms of the breeze, and that's providing us with mirror-like reflections. Interesting how the one lioness seems so much more in tune with hunting and more focused on the analysis. She's the one that's on the right of the screen now. As Franklin seemed to be having a serious debate off to our left. That's who you can hear calling very loudly. As I was saying, that's interesting how the one lioness seems so much more in tune with hunting than the other. But just like humans, certain lions will possess skills that others do not. And you often find lions with better hunting prowess than others within the pride. What a beautiful scene this is. Well, the ripples from her drinking is also creating quite a moody silhouette. I'm sure a lot of you have noticed they paid very little heed to our presence or the vehicles. And Mark, who must be one of our slightly newer viewers, has just asked, have they ever shown any aggression to us or the vehicles? And no, not in my history here, Mark. They are almost oblivious to our presence, and that's after many, many years of very careful interactions between guides and the wild animals here, which have given the animals a sense of, not security, but they certainly are habituated with us and they don't see us as a threat. We never feed them, we never chase them away from their meals. Kind of slots into this very neutral position within the ecosystem, which is actually quite rare. Most things out here either form prey for lion or enemies to lion. You know, like elephant, for example, will be one of the strange ones that don't necessarily fall prey and can actually bully the lions if need be. But we are merely spectators, and because of that, they have started paying very little attention to us. Each time new cubs are born, from a tiny age they are exposed to the vehicles, the noises, our human voices. I think there's some elephants approaching. What is that noise I can hear? Sorry, I'm just going to stop and listen for a second, Mark. I can't be certain, but I think there were some elephants making a noise down in the riverbed below the dam. So we'll go and have a look there a little bit later. But all in all, we have got just about nothing to worry about with these lions. It doesn't mean we still mustn't respect them and take notes of their warning signs and if they are getting upset with our proximity to them, we do need to pay attention to that, because they are entirely wild animals. Forgotten everyone that there are two lions, or two of me, so I'm just going to get on the radio quickly. Stations are two of us in Gala at the Vuyatela Dam. Cover that, Ephraim, perfect. Sorry everyone, I just needed to get those updates in quickly, and I'm not sure if we're still having technical issues. I know we went black screen temporarily, but I hope you're back with us. What I'm probably gonna do is actually loop ahead of these lioness, and we'll be able to get some great shots of them coming towards us. Speed here because we want to try and get ahead of them quickly. Really quick. Yes, we've made it. So I'm just going to head past them on the dam wall. They're just down to our left, and then turn around, and we have some great shots of them with a low angle, hopefully walking straight towards us. Let's hope they abide with what I think their plans might be. Let's see what they do. Keep coming this way towards us, please, ladies. Beautiful. Perfect morning sunshine in their faces. And we basically parked eye level with them. We've dipped into a little spot below the dam wall. And this is going to be awesome. She's looking back longingly at possibly those in Yala. Oh, the one lioness is sadly not looking like she's playing ball with our plans. But let's hope this lioness in front keeps coming towards us. It looks like she may almost flop down and take a rest right there. She's panting heavily. The buffalo meat pressing hard against her diaphragm, causing her to cause short breaths. You know, I wonder What's caused them to move around like this? They do seem a little bit on edge. Kind of not sure what to do. They're all listening in different directions. One's head's pointing to the west, the other to the east. And because their hearing is so much more acute than ours, they may be hearing messages from other lion in the area. Possibly the Birmingham Coalition, or who knows, maybe other members of their pride. Well, I'm very happy to hear that everyone on Twitter is on the same page and would like to stay with these lioness, and so do I now that they're on the move. A lot of you have mentioned that you spend so much time with sleeping lions around and also chewing on that rancid buffalo, and that's certainly true. What's important to remember is that whoever's presenting is usually spending twice as much time in those sightings with you, so we're generally twice as bored of those sightings as you are. You have the privilege of jumping from vehicle to vehicle while we are left waiting patiently for sleeping lion to wake up, which they typically never do. And therefore, I am certainly interested in staying with them. I'm just going to creep forward a bit now. Doesn't look like they're going to continue this way, so my plans to get a great low angle shot of them walking past have not worked out this time around. So it was worth a try, just to get a little bit further up here and see what this lioness is doing. Oh, she may be coughing out a fur ball, I think. I'm not sure exactly which lioness these are from the Nkuhuma Pride. Pam has asked whether they're 4 or 5 years old or possibly older. And like I said, I'm not too sure which two these are, but they certainly look at least around the 4 to 5 year age. I can't see any clear nipples on this individual, which is usually a good sign of an older lioness. So this one possibly hasn't given birth before, because if they have, you can usually see the nipples poking out of the fur. But for those of you who have been spending more time with these lioness with Jamie, if you guys have any idea of who they are or what Jamie may have said regarding their age, please feel free to let us know. But certainly both adults can. Popped on in, we've got another opportunity for a low angle, which I really like making the most of. One lioness isn't going to be in the best spot, but the other will be. Great. I think it's a very similar spot to where they lay up yesterday with Jamie. Ifram's just calling me on the radio. Go ahead, If. On the southeastern side of the dam wall. Well, I'm very glad we did stay and get this brief moment of mobile lions. But let's see how long they're going to get comfortable here for. My guess is that it's going to be quite some time, but hopefully I'm wrong. And what I'm tempted to almost do is, after this head off to the buffalo carcass that they've now left abandoned, and maybe see if there's any hyena getting stuck into that. A lot of you may be wondering where Jamie is. Do not worry, she's okay. They are just doing a few behind the scenes shots of her. I'm not too sure exactly what for, but they're busy doing a little film shoot with Jamie, but she should be finished fairly soon, and that's why you guys have been stuck with me and we haven't been able to divide and conquer this morning just yet, but she will be with us shortly. Ephraim, just come onto the other side of the dam wall. Come onto the other side. Affirmative, Eph. Things are really heating up now that the sun's poking up above these trees. And Michele in Joburg, I'm not sure if we're pronouncing your name wrong, so if you don't mind letting us know exactly how to pronounce it, that'll make chatting a little bit more comfortable with you. And you would like to know, how far are these lions from the buffalo kill? It's probably about 500 meters or so as the crow flies, not very far at all. And Ephraim's just arrived in the sighting, that's why these lioness have popped their heads up. I'm quite surprised actually, usually when they are asleep they play no attention to us. And Carol on Twitter is asking if it's hot. It certainly is hot, Carol. And I'm guessing it's probably going to end up at around 35 degrees Celsius by midday, possibly even warmer than that. And we're in for some seriously hot and humid weather in the summer months. So you're going to see a lot of sweaty presenters for most of the drives. If you're lucky, the first 5 minutes of drive may be cool, and thereafter you're going to be cooking. I remember the last summer here, you'd wake up in the morning, have a cold shower, and whilst having a shave, after a cold shower, there'd be beads of sweat dripping down your forehead. Maybe that's just me, though, and my temperature does run a little bit warmer than others. But it does get extremely hot and humid here. Worth factoring into your safari plans if you ever do want to come out on safari to the Sabi Sands, not necessarily Africa, because it obviously depends on where you go. But the summer months are extremely hot and humid. Okay, well, it appears like we may need to have another vote, everyone. The first vote wasn't at the best time because the lines got up shortly afterwards, and who knows, maybe another vote will induce them to get moving again. But I'm not feeling confident that this is the best place for us to be at this stage of the morning. But that's just my opinion, and if you guys vote otherwise, I will be happy to stay here. You hear more elephants grumbling down in the riverbed below these lines, probably about 500 meters or a kilometer away. As I mentioned earlier, this pride is currently split up. They are missing the remaining four members of their pride. And Angie in Ohio, Gemma in Ohio, and Angie in Portland. Sorry, I always get these names and countries mixed up. Not one of my strengths. But Angie and Gemma would like to know, how long would these pride be able to be split up from their other members and still be able to recognize them if they did reunite? And I would say at least a year, but possibly even longer than that. So I don't think they have anything to worry about when they do come across the other pride members. They spend so much time together, day in, day out, reaffirming bonds when they are together, that I'm confident the time that they have spent apart now will be irrelevant when they do reunite. It'll be as if they were never apart. And I think that could last for up to a year. It's not uncommon for prides to split up and even remain split up, but then bump into one another every now and then and still be amicable and relatively friendly to one another, but then go their own separate ways. So like I say, send your votes through quickly, everyone, and let us know what to do next. Well, good morning, Justin, and good to have you on board with us. I presume you are one of the newer viewers because you are asking whether there are any fish in the larger waterholes. And if you had have been tuned into the show in the last few weeks, you certainly would have seen a large amount of mainly catfish swirling around in the drying ponds. So catfish and tilapia are the two main fish that we get in the ponds here. And Justin would also like to know if these lion will ever attempt to catch them. And in certain parts of Africa, they certainly have been known to catch catfish, especially out of drying waterholes, where they are presented as very easy meals. But it's not common. It's actually more common for leopard to fish catfish out of ponds, and that's often young leopard who are incapable of, well, not incapable, but have yet to master the art of catching mammalian prey that's harder to sink their claws into. But on the topic of animals that swim that lions and both leopards will eat, even crocodiles will be predated on from time to time. And like most predators, anything that is meaty will fall into their diet. Sadly, this year, even though the ponds were very dry, we didn't get to see any leopard or lion trying to fish catfish out of them. But we were lucky enough to see the saddle-billed stork catching a few fish. Some of you guys watching the Juma Dam Cam saw some fish eagles with kills. So the avian predators keep the fish populations in check. And I think it was just almost, I think 2 days ago that we got to see a saddle-billed stork swallowing a little catfish. Okay, everyone, well, it doesn't sound like any of you are sending through votes, so I'm just going to have to make a judgment call here. Well, no, now they're starting to come through, so we're just going to let the voting officials work out what we are going to do next on this democratic safari. And then I think we can make our way off to that buffalo carcass and see what's going on there. Very happy to hear that I've pronounced Mekele's name correctly earlier, as I'd hate to be calling you by the wrong name. And then we've got a request from the Siberia Zumi, who's been controlling the dam cam this morning, and they say they've heard some white-fronted bee eaters and have asked me to have a close look around to see if we can see any of them. I haven't heard them. So, I'm not too sure where to look, but I am looking around, hoping to find one. I haven't seen one yet this summer, so I wonder where they could be. And usually they aren't quite easy to see. They fly around quite a lot. They're hard to miss. They're not very secretive birds, the white-fronted bee eaters. So I'm not sure if it's possibly a different bird call that you're hearing, or maybe I'm just blind and deaf, because I haven't heard them or seen them. Deaf is one thing that is very likely, because my hearing is terrible, especially with one earpiece plugged into my ear. Okay, well, Emily and Ramona want to go and find elephants. And Chris and John want to go and find some leopards. And Carol, Bugsy and Lynn would like to go and see the buffalo carcass. So the majority rule is to leave the lions, which I'm more than happy to do. And I think the first spot for us to stop will be the buffalo carcass. It's going to be the easiest thing to find, and it will be interesting to see what has gone on there in the course of the night, how much the lions have managed to feed on, and whether or not any hyena have made their way onto that scene. Oh. And once we've had a look there, then we will probably make our way to go and find the elephant. And Chris and John, it's not that I don't want to find a leopard. It would probably be my favorite animal to spend time with. But they are tricky to find. And there are none that have been located this morning just yet. So it's not as easy as just pulling one out the bag this morning, which sometimes it is. The game drive radar is usually very useful in that regard, because everybody shares sightings and information. Let me just stop and show Justin catfish that are swirling around this little pond. You'll see mainly their tails poking out, but occasionally you may get to see one of their heads pop up for a drink. I mean for a drink, for a breath of air. They have the ability to process oxygen without using gills like most fish, and they breathe it in just like we do as humans. Most of the catfish remaining in this little waterhole are actually quite large, probably 3 or 4 feet in length. Almost too big for most of the avian predators to catch and swallow. In Siberia, I'm looking around desperately for your white fronted bee eaters, but can't see any sign of them nor hear them. So I haven't forgotten about your request. They're incredibly pretty birds. And another bee eater that I'm looking forward to arriving back here is the southern carmine bee eater. And what I'm going to do is prepare all of you guys for some immense beauty when they do arrive. And I'll just get my book ready to show you a couple of pictures of the bee eaters that we'll get to see. There's also the European bee eater, which is going to be on its way back. Best view of those fish, Justin, but at least you got to see that they are in there. And this is the bird on the top here that the Siberia Zumi thinks they can hear. But there's no sign of them. They're usually flying around quite a lot, especially at this time of the morning. And even last summer, I don't remember seeing too many white-fronted bee eaters here. My memories of white-fronted bee eaters in the Sabi Sands are mainly along the river course, which we don't have much or any of here. And let me just read you actually quickly. Habitat usually associated with riverbanks along watercourses and dry woodland. So that we're in the dry woodland, but we don't have much river frontage here. And the other bee eater that I'd like to show you guys when they arrive back is the southern carmine bee eater. Look at those incredible colors. So that's something to look forward to, one of the about 200 birds that will return to this area, having spent time away in our winter months. Okay. So that's something to prepare yourselves for. I'm sure a lot of you will be eager to get a few more birds onto your bird lists. And for the newer viewers, it is something that I strongly suggest, getting a bird list going. Even if it's this morning, we'll try and get you your first few specimens. And that way you keep track of what you have seen, and it kind of creates a natural competitive edge that us humans possess. and you will want to get more and more birds and add them to the list, and it's a great way to learn about them. And a lot of the time on these drives, it's the birds that entertain us, not the big animals that we often battle to find or are fast asleep. The birds are always putting on a show. You would have noticed that that waterhole is very low, and James is interested to know if I think we're going to get enough rain to fill it up. Well, there's certainly going to be enough rain to increase its level dramatically, but how full it gets, I have no idea, James. Can you believe it? The places these vehicles can go, and then we've just got stuck on the road. But it's hard to say. If we have another dry rainfall year like last year, James, then it's not looking too promising to fill it up, but I'm guessing, or hoping rather, that we are going to get some regular rainfall, and it should fill up considerably. I was chatting to some guests that I've been coming to Vuyatela for many, many years now. Oh. That'll explain it. We have got a flat tire. Anyway, I was explaining to guests I was chatting with guests who've been here year in and year out, and they were here just a few weeks ago, and they said this is the lowest they've ever seen it. So it's interesting stuff. The area where we were actually parked earlier, where you could see a lot of erosion, was from where the dam wall actually broke due to huge rainfalls, and the dam wall couldn't actually support all the water, and it crumbled in that section where we were parked below the line. So anything is possible. It could be a flood year where the dam cannot actually cope with the amounts of water, or it could be another dry one. I'm not too sure as to what is going to happen though. So now you guys have the joy of being with us while we change this tire. I'll rely on Andrew to update me on any messages from the final control room. Whether we're going to send you across to Jamie at any point, but I'm not too sure if she's busy. So basically the first step in changing a tire is coming to the hood of the vehicle and taking off the high level jack. It shouldn't be too difficult, although I'm not getting off to a great start here. And these are new and are very useful because you don't have to use a spanner to remove bolts. We can just easily with our hands or a Leatherman get these little ring bolts off, you could call them. The previous bolts were a little bit time consuming, so these are a happy new addition to this vehicle. And then we reveal the high level jack. It's a serious piece of equipment, this. Ta-da! We've got some gaffer tape here to hold it in place, and I'm just going to remove quickly. And I'll try and show you how it works, but the tricky thing about changing the tires and involving you guys is that you can't really see what we're doing because the camera cannot get off the vehicle. So I'm just going to pop this down there, make sure the handbrake is up, and make sure the car is in gear so that it doesn't roll forward as we jack it up. Wheel spanner, useful for removing the bolts off the wheels. It's the back right tire that's the problem. And what I'm going to do is just loosen the bolts before getting the jack in, because obviously if I jack the car up and try and loosen the bolts, the tire is just going to spin. So excuse me for a second. actually might be useful. I'm going to try something here. It may not work, but if it does, I will consider myself a genius. So, I'm going to get my phone out, put it on video mode, and then Andrew might be able to focus in on the camera. And show you guys what I'm doing down here. Is that gonna work, Andrew? Is the angle wrong?
I think it's gonna work.
Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to the tire changing operation. Is it working, Andrew?
Yes.
Cool. Well, I think we found a looper here. Now you guys can be involved in the tire changing. Shame, this poor tire is not looking very good, is it? I suppose you can't see too much of it though. But does that mean Link? Okay, Andrew just motioned to me this, which obviously means Link in sign language. So we can send you across to Jamie and we will be back up and running in the next 5 minutes or so. So goodbye and see you later.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to my slightly delayed start to the Sunrise Safari. For those of you who don't know, my name is Jamie, and I have Viam on camera with me this morning. And the wildebeest and I are now off on a mission to see what's happening at the hyena den and see if those hyenas are out and about. Shame, poor Scott and his flat tire. I'm very carefully watching mine, which has a slightly slower puncture than Scott's apparently was. But my front right is definitely looking flatter than it was when we first set out this morning. But fingers crossed we're going to make it through the drive before I have to change it and get it pumped up and fixed. And this morning we were just doing a little bit of filming around quarantine while you were with Scott and those lions. Getting a little bit of footage of VM flying the drone and a couple of fun shots with Jandre sitting on the front of the car looking very much like he was about to fall off. Luckily we've managed to keep him on and we're now en route and we can go out looking for all of the animals around here. Let's go see if we can find those hyena. Hopefully they're out. It's a little bit late. Morning! Saying good morning to some of the ground crew at Juma. I set out this morning in shorts and I seriously regret it. It's actually chillier than I expected it to be. Kind of hoping that the sun's going to come out and start to warm us up a little bit. Thank you to the viewers who sent through suggestions as to how we can approach smelly carcasses in future. Both Andrew and myself were smelling dead buffalo long into the night last night, despite getting into a shower and scrubbing and changing clothes. It sort of follows you around for a while. For elephants as well. I'm sure I heard them cracking branches and talking to each other somewhere around here. Ah, it's still looking okay. It's still there. I think we're okay. I'm not sure if Scott was in that block with those lionesses at and with the dead buffalo. But if he was, that would very much be an explanation for any flat tire. That block is just a recipe for flat tires. I'm sure it's responsible for the slope puncture as well. It's a collection of thorn trees and sickle bush and all kinds of nasty spine things. Sure, that's going to be a tricky one. I'm hoping it stays there. Liam, can you see that? Oh, nope. Here he goes, away again. It's sort of the first time I've been hearing them call. It's called an oriole. And let me just grab my bird book so I can show you why I wanted to point it out. Let's listen and just see if we can hear it whistling. Mm-hmm. It's that little whistle. And they really are the most incredible looking birds. I'm sort of sitting here hoping that it's going to fly back towards the road. Here we go. This is the one that we're hearing. It's this incredibly striking yellow and black bird. Oh, it's being sneaky. I can hear it. You can see how really striking it is. And although they're around all season, it's only at this sort of time of year that you start to hear them calling and moving about, because it's obviously breeding season for most birds. Really, really pretty bird. You get a lot of different orioles, but this is the most common one. Now, I'm not sure, what do you think? Do you think we should go looking for it and find a marula tree instead, like Scott managed yesterday morning? Oh, there's no big marulas to crash into. And I don't think I could quite do it, pull it off with the same sense of style that Scott did. I can assure you that we were all highly entertained by that. Just a gentle bump. Where is it? It's hiding here somewhere. You can hear it whistling away. The black-headed oriole is always around throughout the season, but as I said, you only start to hear them now. But one of the most important seasonal indicators is the woodland kingfisher. Well, good morning, King Alan, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. I haven't yet heard a woodland kingfisher. We're always listening for them, and it's kind of unmistakable. That incredible, it's a sound I can't imitate. I'd love to try. It would be a poor effort. You'd probably laugh. It's a sort of a downward trill. That wasn't terrible, but it wasn't ideal. It's the most beautiful striking bird, and it's always exciting when we first see them. I don't know where our black-headed oriole's gone. It's vanished. But no, King Alan, I haven't yet seen the woodland kingfisher. It's a little bit early for them still. Probably got another month or so. At least in this area. It varies between place to place. Hello, Impala. Good morning, boys. You're not going to be very easy to film this morning, are you? Tucked away in there. Let's try and find a gap. Just an update as to where we are. We're currently sitting on Aubrey's Road, which is close to the hyena den. just a couple of hundred meters ahead of us. Oh, look how green it's looking. Well, there you go, Nancy. An animal that isn't the big five. And we're on our way to a predator that isn't part of the big five, so we've definitely got plenty planned for you that's not big five based. I was even seriously contemplating, but I think I'm going to leave it a little bit later into the season. It's something Jandre and I were discussing last night, doing a little five drive, although I think that might be a little bit easier to do on a bushwalk. So heading out and trying to find things like a rhino beetle and an antlion, buffalo weaver, leopard tortoise. I haven't seen the tortoises out yet, but it shouldn't be too long. It's getting to be just after the first rains and it is nice and warm, so they should be out and about soon. We'll be peering into the grass and see if we can see any of them moving around. Best one I ever found was probably about that big. It was so cute. Tiny little baby one, so we'll be keeping our eyes peeled for them. And then the elephant shrew, I think the elephant shrew is going to be the trickiest one if we adopt that particular tactic and go looking for the small five. They're very shy, very secretive, and very much nocturnal. But I've learned a little bit about them, and they have their own little pathways through thick bushes. So if you can find an elephant shrew nest site, then your chances are much, much higher of actually encountering them. And I think that's it. Those are the small five. That's what we'll be looking for at some point a little bit later in the season. Okay, Nancy, let's see what else we can find you. And of course, all the other viewers as well. A sort of a gentle ticking sound as the wheel turns. It's actually quite relaxing in its own way. If you look past whatever it means for the vehicle, poor Jigger. Of viewers like Safari Haze that you get orioles of different species, even the kind with apparently little white pants on in the US. And Wendy, you were saying you get them in Nebraska, and you were wondering if they migrate across to this area or to South Africa for the summer months. And I'm just thinking about it, I don't think so. I think the only one we get here that is a migratory species is the European oriole, which, as its name suggests, comes from Europe or migrates across from Europe. And that's pure gold looking. It's bright, bright yellow all the way from head to tail. But they're extraordinary looking birds. I'm not sure how many orioles there are in the family, but I think it's quite a big one. And they're an interesting bird because one of their dominant, at least in this area, their dominant food types is hairy caterpillars. So those furry caterpillars that make you itch terribly. Good morning, giraffe. Oh, it's our same giraffe. The same one we saw on Aubrey's Road the other day with a baby. Let's go back a bit. Oh, he's right at the back there. Here we go. There's our little baby from before, a couple of nights ago. Already looking a little bit older. Somehow, maybe because he's not next to mom. Hello, little one. Good morning. Let's go have a look at your... see if we can get a nice view of your mom. Now, for those of you who weren't watching, we had the most amazing sighting with this little giraffe and its mother. Mom was lying down and baby was standing next to her, but still considerably shorter despite the fact that mom was lying down. And they had a little bit of a cuddle and some affection, which I think it's probably my best giraffe sighting to date. There's mom there. I say it's the same one, I'm pretty sure it is. It's a little bit difficult. Obviously their spot patterns are unique, but I suspect, given our location, that it is the same one, especially since her baby is so, so tiny. And look how beautiful she looks. She's really quite an attractive looking female. Got a beautiful colour to her. It's a shiny tan. Enjoying her breakfast there. And I'm hoping that maybe baby's going to feel a bit braver and come a little bit closer. That's why I got so excited the other day when we had them right next to each other. Because usually this is the situation. You usually see the calf quite far away from the mother. I haven't had a chance to read it yet, but I saw that as much has been done into the way that giraffes communicate with each other. And it's really interesting. I haven't had a chance to read it. I only saw it at 5 o'clock this morning. But that's definitely something I'm going to be reading up on later. Look how beautiful she is. She's very solid looking. She's got quite prominent shoulder blades. Very pretty. I'm sure many of you will have read that off. Welcome back, and we do apologize for the breakup in signal, but it appears that we are back up and running, and we have this time made it to the correct hyena den. Unfortunately, it doesn't look like anybody's home, or if they are, they're not out and about at the moment. Sterling's wren warbler making that noise. There's also, just having a look, although it is very quiet, they have dragged something back to the den. I'm going to reverse slightly so that we can try and have a look at what it is. It's a bit of a tricky navigation area, this. At least have found our way to the right den. I don't know what they've got there. Let's grab my binoculars and let us have a look at what we're seeing. If you look there, it looks as though... yeah. Fairly rotten. Looks like part of a leg or a bone. It's definitely got that slightly white tinge to it, so it's been around a while. And we've spoken a lot about hyenas stashing their kills in water holes. Quite a short, quite a stumpy looking leg. Very thick. Could be something like a hippo. Although I said that last time and it was in fact a warthog, so you know. We haven't exactly got a good record in terms of determining what the hyenas have around their den site. Anyway, since it is quiet, I just want to sit here for a moment and see if maybe curiosity plays a role and the little cubs decide to come and investigate what we're doing out here. It is a little bit late in the morning. We were just taking a chance to see if they're out and about. But I was in the middle of answering James's question, and I'm going to just grab my book out for those of you who aren't familiar with the birds that we were talking about. So James asked us if we see the crimson-breasted shrike in this area, and the answer is no, we don't. But they're not too far away. Let me just find what I'm looking for. 394. Here we go. Really extraordinary looking bird. And you can see why it's called crimson-breasted. It's not difficult to see at all. Really stunning bird. I haven't yet managed to see a yellow morph one. And I promise you I'll be very excited when I do. But they're quite large little birds, about 25 centimeters, which is, what is that in inches? 10 inches high, with a very, very solid beak for catching and butchering insects. But if we just have a look at our distribution map, when I said they're more towards the western areas, we are right on the fringe of their range, so we're just on the eastern edge of that green area. So that's where they occur. And I used to work in a camp just inside that green area, and we'd see them all the time. I never managed to get a good photo of one though. Not sure how I managed that. I tried and tried for ages, but very, very striking little birds. So that is the crimson-breasted shrike for James. We haven't seen them. I'll be very excited if we did see them, but we've got our own range of really pretty looking shrikes. There's still no sign of life around the den. It's all dead quiet. Now, I know the adults like to lie up in this open patch over here, but I don't see any of them. And probably because they are mainly nocturnal, the adults are lying up sleeping somewhere, or they're feasting on a meal that's somewhere outside of this area. And the cubs have gone into hiding for now. And you generally find that when the adults are not around, then the cubs are much less brave and excitable. Okay, well, since all is quiet at the hyena den, it's time for us to make our way out of this block and find our way back onto the road, wherever the road might be. Long shot, but we did give it a go. Oopsie. A very funny feeling to the weather this morning. I have this horrible feeling we're getting another cold front. Just when it got warm enough to put shorts back on, seems as though the weather's closing in on us. With this tree to answer the next question, if we can. Now, we've been driving through quite a thick block. There's a lot of trees that are in the area. Now, Marilyn, you wanted to know what the trees are with the big thorns. There's quite a few of them. This is one such example. It's a bit tricky in silhouette, but If you see a tree with large white thorns, and I'm not going to go too much into the technical argument, it's what I've always known as an acacia tree. In this particular case, it's, you can see that flaky bark all around the thorns. That is a flaky thorn acacia. And those are true thorns. So they're actually modified leaf structures, which makes them a little bit softer than the other types of thorns that we get. You can see they're budding green leaves. You were wondering if the elephants and the giraffe will eat them, and absolutely they will. It's incredible to watch. It really, really is. You wouldn't believe how they can wrap their tongue around a branch just like that one that's covered in thorns and run it along and strip it of all the leaves. In the case of the elephants, they might even put the entire thing in their mouth and chomp it and eat it completely. And they, part of that is because their mouths are reinforced with melanin, which, apart from being a dark pigment, is a very, very tough pigment. It provides lots of stability within the sort of the soft membranes inside their mouths. It's still mind-boggling to me every time I see it. And what I wanted to do was find you a sickle bush as well. There are a couple of them around. I'll keep my eyes out for you, and then you must look at some serious thorns. And those are the thorns. They're actually not thorns, they're modified branches to create spines. Those are some seriously tricky customers. And that's the kind of tree, a sickle bush is the kind of tree that you really, really don't want to drive over, because they don't bend like acacia thorns do. They're incredibly tough. Okay, I'm seeing a couple of small sickle bush, but I want to find a nice example. I also appear to have driven myself into a thicket. Not go this way. I swear this place wasn't as difficult to navigate the last time I was here. Oh well, shall make our way out. Look, I think the elephants have been through. They've put a whole load of new trees down. Nope, we can't go this way. Actually, this isn't a bad example, just for completeness to finish this question. This particular sickle bush doesn't have quite the level of spines that I was talking about, but you can still see what I mean. If we have a look here, these are incredibly tough modified branches that come to these points. And I've seen elephants put branches, entire branches of this plant, into their mouths. It's incredible to watch. And those thorns are so, so sharp and so strong. And this is actually how we know that they are modified branches rather than modified leaves or modified leaf structures. Because if we have a look, we can actually, in places you can see where leaves are growing out of the spines themselves. And that's what those elephants are after. They're after those new shoots, like so. Really, really interesting tree to see. It is, however, part of the reason that my route out of here appears to be blocked. It's amazing. I swear there were not this many fallen trees last time I was here. But the road is just there. And while I scramble my way out, let's see what Scott has been up to. And I will catch up with you a little bit later.
Welcome back, everyone. And I'm told Jamie is searching for a specific tree for you, and couldn't help but stop for this beautiful tree wisteria, one of the early bloomers, covered in bright purple flowers. It's really interesting how it's pushed out its flowers before its leaves. And the leaves will come later on in the summer. Very pretty tree. There are not too many of them in the Sabi Sands. And the last one I tried to show you, we didn't have the best view of it. It was in the Milwati riverbed. We couldn't get quite close enough to it as I would have liked, so there's a closer view of them. I'm just going to stop and listen. There's a very pretty bird that's calling, and its call matches its appearance. It's called the black-headed oriole. Listen carefully for a... There it goes. I'm going to ask Andrew to point the camera in the direction that the noise is coming from so that you hopefully pick up the audio a little bit better. I'm not sure if you're hearing that. Let's just creep forward a little bit and see if we can try and find it. It's a bright yellow bird with a black head. Can be mistaken with a weaver at a first glance. Let's see if we can jiggle our way through here and get you a closer view. We are on Arethusa, making our way towards the reports of Shadow and Sindile, two leopards on a dike kill. The report was from last night.
Here it is.
Well done, Andrew spotted it. I can't see it, so I'm glad he's here. Oh, well done, Andrew. Awesome. Well, we're just going to have to tweak some of the camera settings. The lighting's not easy, but you... And would you believe that Jamie just showed you one of these in your bird book? So the luck is on our side this morning. And I'm glad we got a brief glimpse of it before it flew off. It looks like it must have landed though, because Andrew's going in again. Oh, there it is, hopping through the branches. It looks like it's feeding on little insects. Doesn't it have a wonderful call? Well, this is a good one for the bird lists that I was speaking up about a little bit earlier. Wonderful to notice how much vocal a lot of the birds become in the summer months. This bird was here throughout the winter, but we very seldom heard it or actually got to see it. They may have very slightly migrated off to areas surrounding us and then come back. Not a major migration, you could say, but a seasonal movement. But good to have them around and singing for us again. Well done, Andrew.
Thank you, sir.
Well, that was lucky. I really wasn't sure that we were going to get a view of it, so glad that worked out. And now we can keep on making our way through towards Second Windmill Road, which is basically just north of the Arethusa Dam. And I was hugely surprised to hear that update late yesterday evening that they had been found on this kill. Shadow must have made the kill during the course of the day and then moved through what was an incredibly hot day yesterday, quite some distance to get to Sindile, who we saw on actually Juma at the end of the Sunrise Safari, the way to collect him and then take him back to that kill. And you'll be glad to know that she hoisted the Daika kill, and she hasn't been doing too well with the hoisting, but I think it's simply because she might be too small to hoist the bigger kills that she makes, like Impala, and that's why a lot of the time they get stolen. But all of the smaller kills I've seen her with, she has hoisted, so maybe she's not such a bad mother as people have suggested for various reasons. She's been unable to raise any of her six litters to maturity, so this young male is her first hope at getting it right. A lot of people have said that it's because she doesn't always hoist her kills, and that's certainly a very good point. But if she's not big enough and strong enough to hoist a large male impala that she's managed to kill up into a tree, that doesn't necessarily make her a bad mom. It does mean it is a more dangerous environment for cubs to be around, feeding on kills on the ground. If hyena or lion or wild dogs come charging in to try and steal the kill, the cubs could often get caught in the crossfire. Just gonna see if I'm close enough to any of the game drive vehicles to be in communications with them. We basically have to be a few hundred meters away to hear them, and there could well be a lot of people queuing up for this sighting, or possibly the sighting's dissolved and they've already finished the diker and moved off. But we've come here in search of an update on all of that. Can any station help me with an update on Shadow and Pontoine? Morning, yes, I can copy you. Okay, copy that. Sorry, I missed it. Confirm I can make my way to join you. Okay, copy. Thanks very much. I should be there in the next couple of minutes. Okay, good news. A crackling message over the radio tells me that they are still in the same place, which is great news. I'm not too sure whether they're feeding up the tree, down the tree, how much is left, but we will be there very soon to find out for ourselves. And the good news is, on the way there, we're going to have to pop over the Arethusa Dam wall, so we should have some beautiful scenes shortly. Jamie would like you guys to hop onto her vehicle. I'm not entirely sure, but there's a strong chance you are going to be sent across to Jamie while we make our way into the sighting. So toodle-doo if you do go. If you are going to stay with us, well then, don't take heed of the last message. I'm just battling to copy Jess in the final control room.
Welcome back, and what I have just discovered is the reason I was finding it so difficult to navigate around when I didn't remember it being that difficult was because I was at a completely wrong den site. They obviously have two that they're utilizing in this area, or at least they've dragged that bit of kill outside another den or possible den. And we've arrived at the original hyena den that we found. We've only got this one adult here who's looking rather scruffy and a little bit dirty. I suspect like she's been eating all night. She's definitely got a very round belly. But here is the actual den site and the entrance to one of the entrances to the den, which makes a lot more sense. I was very confused. I couldn't work out why nothing looked like it did before. But at least I have an answer. I was in not completely the wrong place. We were about 100 meters off from where we needed to be. It's actually surprisingly difficult to navigate through a block when it's cloudy like this. Can be a little bit, oof, I just got a whiff of her. Can be a little bit disorienting. She still smells better than the buffalo did though last night. But I wouldn't describe her smell as particularly pleasant. But just have a look at how scruffy she looks. Shame, sorry girl. But you're definitely not the prettiest hyena I've ever seen. And I think she's quite an old hyena. She's starting to get those balding patches. Oh, such a round belly. Liam and I were just discussing whether or not hyenas can eat more per body weight ratio than lions can, and trying to work out exactly how much they could eat in one sitting. Oh, there's actually another hyena, but it's really tucked away. Sorry, I got distracted by a flash of movement. Behind this fallen tree, behind the patch of grass at the bottom, every now and again a little ear twitches. And I wonder if that's not a cub behind there. It's tucked away, I'm not even sure if we can see the movement there. But there is another hyena around. I think I can see it because I'm slightly further forward to where Viam is. There's another little guy, but for now, because I can't reposition without going all the way around, let's stick with this lady. You can see all the edges of her ears where they've been chewed on and chewed raw. It could be probably from types of flies and other parasites that have exacerbated that, although I'm sure that having cubs chewing on your ears doesn't help. But generally that's from a special type of fly. Oh, well, she looks very content, quite happy with life, and unbelievably full. That belly is absolutely enormous. Trying to work it out. Maybe eat 15 kilograms of food, 20 kilograms of food in a sitting. And she probably doesn't weigh much more than 60 or 80 kilograms, but probably 80 kilograms at the moment with that belly. She looks quite large, this girl. She definitely has a distinct odor. I can hear another vehicle approaching. I do just want to get onto the Game Drive channel and find out what's happening. A station on Aubrey's Road come in. Are you coming to visit Misikaya? No, negative, but I've got your audio. I've just arrived here. There looks like one adult and maybe one mpimpan at the back, but not much activity. Just letting Andrew know. I could hear another vehicle coming through. Okay, copy that. Come north from where you are. Your audio is almost directly south of me. Andrew's having exactly the same problem that I had earlier, which is trying to figure out where exactly we are in one of the world's most disorienting blocks. Now let's see if we can shuffle forward a little bit. I don't want to disturb her in any way. Let's see if we can get a visual and check up if that is one of the cubs hiding there. I thought at first it was a bird or an insect there until I realized it was an ear. Stop there. Good morning. Oh, look how sleepy she looks. Blinking away. Oh my word, look at that belly. It's not a cub, it's another adult, the back that she's going to go lie down near. And that is that big female, she's the mother of the youngest cub. She's got that scar on her back. And there's the other little one, tucked away. It's not a cub. Looks like the adult, could be the mother of the twins. They're standing by Andrew. Sorry guys. He's desperately trying to navigate his way through the block. And they've settled down exactly on the opposite side of that bush. So I think let us go all the way around and find a nice open spot somewhere at the back there that we can have a look at them from a nice comfortable distance. Oh, but it seems as though Scott has an awesome surprise for you. So from one spotted predator to another, let's go across and see what Scott has and I'll catch up with you a little bit later.
Welcome back everyone, and we're in luck. Got a great view of Shadow feeding on the remains of this male duiker kill. And clearly she's taken it down from the tree. It's not uncommon for leopards to bring their kills down from a tree if there's no immediate threats around and feed on them in a more comfortable area. It can be quite awkward feeding up in a tree. But rest assured, if she heard any hyena or any rustles approaching in the vegetation around us, she would very quickly latch onto the duiker and get it up into a nearby marula tree, which we will show you shortly. But for now, while she's feeding, it's a good opportunity for us to show you this. It may end very shortly. Well, there's a vehicle moving around. They're just making their way towards Sindile, the young male. He's just over a year of age and he's, I'm told, about 50 meters off, relaxing in the shade. And as the vehicle moves, she's just a little bit cautious and she won't be able to hear the sound of any other animals approaching. So that's why she's sat up now, just to make extra sure. And I'm sure as soon as that vehicle turns off and gets into position, she'll continue. Well, sadly, I'm not going to be able to chat with you now because I cannot hear any of the questions you're sending through to me. So apologies for that. You're just going to have to listen to me waffle on. Oh, is she going to take it back up the tree? She may well. I think we're in luck. Everybody get ready to take some screenshots. Here she goes. Anna. He's just hiding it under the bush. False alarm. This is also very typical behavior of leopards, to just stash their kills under bushes. And Andrew, if you don't mind zooming down where to where her tail is, you can actually see a lot of fur from the duiker that they would have plucked off for easy feeding. So they've been obviously doing a lot of feeding in this area at the base of this large marula tree, which I'm guessing is the tree that she had hoisted the kill up into. A nice easy tree for her to hoist into. Shallow, or very low fork, high enough to get her prey into a safe place away from hyena. I'm just gonna give it a second to see what she does. She's directly behind the tree at the moment, but it looks like she may be moving back into our view. There we go. I think she may be sniffing around here looking for any little tidbits. She's also looking very intently. Watch closely here. I think she's chuffing, which is a way that leopards communicate. It's a small... There we go. She's in the cub. Watch your... Very difficult to see, but she's basically going out of her nostrils and mouth and letting off the odd grunt to call Sindile. And won't it be wonderful? I'm just going to reposition the vehicle ever so. Listen to his mother's calls, and you can just see him between the other vehicle and his mother. And she obviously thinks he needs to have a little bit more breakfast. Although, this is interesting behavior. Looks like she may be snarling at him now. So this is a fairly typical love-hate relationship that we've seen between that we will see between Shadow and this youngster. She could well be pregnant now and was mating about 3 weeks ago. And as she gets closer to giving birth, she's going to become a lot less tolerant of him. Now she's snarling at him. We can't really see from this angle, but watch her ears. So I was trying to give her... The confusing stuff is she called him and then now she's kind of shouting at him. Fascinating. But it is, like I said, this love-hate relationship between an adult leopardess and her cub, which is reaching independence. And she needs to start teaching him that she's not going to continue to feed him for much longer. Or at least she would prefer not to. But what I've seen in the past is that young leopards, just like this, will still tag along once their mother has given birth to the next litter. In his case, he's already bigger than her, so she can't overpower him. And they are family after all, so she's going to always have this forgiving side of her that will tolerate him. Let's see what happens here as he gets closer to the kill. I mean, the fact that she went all the way to call him from where he was, probably 2 miles away from here, after she had made the kill, is testament to the fact that she does still care for him. But that snarling earlier was very, very interesting. Looks like he's trying to latch onto this dike and this thick undergrowth. You may well feed on it in there or pull it out for us. That would be the best, I guess. Really, really interesting behavior. I'm so glad we got you when we did. Anyway, as I was saying, it's not uncommon for young leopards who are technically supposed to be independent to tag along with their mother. And I hope this happens with Shadow and Sindile, because if she does give birth to the next litter, what could well happen and what I have seen in the past is that he will hang around with the new additions, the young cubs, almost acting like a babysitter through default. So while she goes off hunting, they aren't going to be left completely alone, and they are going to have some relatively experienced eyes and ears looking after them. And what that means is every time she returns to her cubs, meaning the new additions, to take them to their next meal, he's going to get to tag along and enjoy the freebie. And I've seen that happening with a much older leopard than Sandile. He was about 2 years old when his mother gave birth. And even still, she tolerated him. And we actually had some sightings where we saw five leopards all together. The mother, the father, so in this case it would be Shadow and Tingana. The older brother, in this case Sandile. And the two new cubs. Hopefully one male, one female. Then we get the best of both worlds. Now we don't have the best view from here, so I'm just going to reposition slightly and see if we can't get you guys a better spot. I don't think we're going to be able to see the yaks very well regardless of where we park, but at least here we'll be able to have a better view of his mom. We're probably only about 4 or 5 meters away, so we're going to be able to get you some great close-up shots. A message for the newer viewers, we are incredibly, incredibly fortunate to be able to be this close to leopard. The lion that we saw earlier are far easier to habituate and get used to vehicles, and you'll find most reserves and parks throughout Africa will have good lion viewing where they tolerate the vehicles. Whereas leopard are a very, very different animal. They've taken many, many, oh, the flies are giving it a hard time. Sorry, Shadow. Doesn't look like much fun. As I was saying, leopards are highly elusive animals, and it's taken many, many years of gentle coaxing from the guides in this area to reassure the leopard that we don't mean any harm. They can allow us insight into their lives. And this is one of the best places in Africa to view leopard. And to be this close to one is an absolute privilege that we must all not forget about, even the older viewers. It's easy to become complacent and forget how lucky we are. But look at this. Oh, I think she almost got that one. It looked to me like she... I think she opened her mouth too quickly to seal the deal, but it almost looked like she got it in her mouth. It'll be interesting to see. Maybe we can play a little slow motion clip for you to see how close she is getting to that fly. Because I could almost guarantee that it was in her mouth. Maybe it was an optical illusion though. Let's see if I can snap off one or two pics of the fly hunt. Oh, here she goes again. And I wonder if it's worth trying at least to see if you can get a half a decent angle on Sandile. Seems like he's found a good portion of the carcass to chew on. Oh, not too bad. You can see him busy at work there, having his breakfast. Maybe his mother was hissing and snarling at him because he was late for breakfast this morning, guys. it's no different to a sighting we had a couple of weeks ago, actually the day before we saw her mating with Tingana. She came into an area where she left him in the morning, and she was calling insistently, but a softer contact call. Wow, wow, wow. And that didn't work. So she eventually resorted to a much louder rasping call, which leopards were used to communicate over bigger distances. And eventually, after about an hour of desperate calling, he arrived. And they reunited and they seemed happy. And 10 or 15 minutes later, she turned around and started snarling at him. So I guess it's this confusing time for a mother, especially considering she hasn't managed to raise cubs to this level of maturity. So she's never been through this hard breakup before. But it's completely necessary. She does need to focus her attention, or at least try and focus her attention, on raising the next litter. She's just about done her job here. Some people may say that she's a little bit premature in giving birth to the next litter. Usually it's around 18 months to 2 years of age that a leopardess will give birth again. But at this rate, it could be at around 13 months or 14 months. So a few months early. But I don't think that's going to have a massive impact on Sandile, because like I said, I'm fairly certain he's just going to hang around and be that kid who doesn't want to leave home. What I'm going to do is probably turn on my phone. I hope it doesn't interfere with the audio, and just see if Jess and Final Control is trying to send me any messages, because I basically have zero comms with her. So we're going to start using WhatsApp technology, which I'm sure a lot of you are aware of. Okay, awesome. Well, WhatsApp technology has come to the rescue, and we are ready for a slow motion fly replay. It's quite a long clip of about 40 seconds, so enjoy it. And I wish I was getting to watch it as well. And we will see you shortly. When do you think 40 seconds is up?
Thirty, thirty-one, thirty-two, thirty-three, thirty-four, thirty-five, thirty-six, thirty-seven, thirty-eight, thirty-nine, forty,
we'll give 5 extra seconds in case 41, 42, 43, 44, 45. I'm guessing you guys are back. I hope you're back with us. And I fear that I've started speaking too early and the fly clip may still be playing. But Andrew and I are convinced that now the 40 seconds are up and you are back with us in real time, no more slow motion. I hope you enjoyed that clip. It must have looked awesome. Now, one thing that we haven't touched on this morning is the updates on Sandile, this young male leopard's rabies inoculations. Fear not, the Sabi Sands are on top of everything, and we are letting them do their business, which they are well versed at. It's not the first time they have had to deal with a situation like this. And as soon as they are ready to provide us with any more information, but we must remember that there are professional people going about their business, and the less we get involved and pester them, the better they'll be able to do their jobs. This young male leopard is being taken
Teller access for tracks. So that very large hyena was just a little bit flat, and we do apologize. We do apologize for the breakup in spot signal. Now I've just bumped into Andrew, who tells me that those two lionesses are still lying up at the dam in a beautiful position. So we're on our way there for now, and we'll be back again with those hyenas for the sunset safari, hopefully to see them out and about a little bit more. I think they were so stuffed full of food that moving wasn't really an option. BM and I were just chatting a little bit about their incredible ability to not only fill their stomachs, but also to descend it to the point that, distend it to the point that they manage to squash all of their other internal organs in there as well. It's unbelievable. I mean, looking at that belly on that hyena, she was probably the most stuffed full of food animal I've ever seen. And I've seen some very big lions. But it's good to know they're being fed, or at least are feeding themselves. And here are the winds picked up. I cannot believe we're in for another cold front. It's just got warm again. Back towards those lionesses. I think that Scott's signal is back up and running and he's got his picture back. So let's head across to him, because he does have those wonderful leopards, and we will catch up with you a little bit later.
Two, one. We love Andrew. Bye. I was just saying goodbye to Nikki, who is now using cell phone technology to let me know when we're live or not. And sorry about the loss of signal a bit earlier, not sure what would have caused that. So I must just touch over, it was at a critical point in a little discussion I was having with you guys, and that is on the topic of young Sandile, who we can't see too well, he's still snacking on the dike in the bush, and his inoculation process. The Sabi Sands are doing a great job and everything in their power to make sure that his inoculation process continues going smoothly, which it is up till date. So we've got nothing to worry about, and this leopard is in very good hands, and the people that are dealing with the situation have done it many times before. And we all just need to take a few steps back. As much as we care for him and are concerned for him, so are they, and they are the professionals. And if we put ourselves in their situation, we would prefer to be left alone to do our business without a million people pestering. answers and questions and information. They will provide us with information as soon as they are ready to. And like I say, let's just let them do their job. It's not their first rodeo, and they are doing a great job up till date and have done a great job in the past with many, many different scenarios that they've been faced with the wild animals out here. We must remember that they are all conservationists and love wildlife, and that is why they are working out here in the industry. But this leopard is in very, very good hands, and we're not keeping any secrets from you. We are just letting the professionals do their job, and as soon as they've got any relevant updates for us, they'll let us know, and we will in turn pass that information on to all of you. But for now, everything is going smoothly, so we can all take a deep breath and just be grateful that we do have a team of professionals who are experienced and know what they're doing looking after this young male. Just to give you, the new viewers who may be joining for the first time, a little bit more insight into the matter, and just to touch on it briefly, basically there was a domestic dog which broke into the reserve from the surrounding villages, and it was infected with rabies, and this young male leopard, who we can see vaguely in the bushes now, caught it. So it is now going through an inoculation process to make sure that it does not get infected as well. Excuse me. Looks like all the easy parts of the carcass have already been fed on, and now he's having to be a little bit more meticulous in his feeding in order to get the little bits of remaining meat. It looks like he's feeding on the rib cage now. Forgetting to check my phone for communication from the final control. It's the first time that I'm using this, and I've got some questions coming through. I'm just waiting for them to download. Thankfully we are in a good signal area here. A lot of the areas out here you have to climb trees in order to simply make a phone call, but now thankfully we are elevated. Oh, looks like Sandina is thinking about moving. Possibly had enough to snack on for now. And he's moved ever so slightly into certainly a better spot for us to see him in. Where is he going to move off to now? Probably going to find a shady spot out in the open where he can get a little bit more of the breeze. Interestingly, he's also sniffing around. Obviously they were feeding on the kill on that area as well, and they're just making sure there's no little titbits lying around there. Now that the wind's picked up, the scent of this kill will be blowing far and wide, and we must all be ready for some action. A hyena comes onto the scene. That would be the most probable animal to respond to the scent of a kill. But if any lion were in the area, Tingana, the big male leopard who's dominant in this area, and also the father of this cub, could also appear. Sadly, there have been no wild dogs in the immediate area. They're also a likely candidate, but there's none close by. Now, we've got a question through from Romay, and it's an interesting one. As we saw her call him a bit earlier, she then walked through the bush, almost where he's coming now, to the point where she's lying down. And Romay's interested to know if she thinks that was a message leading him to where she had put the kill. Quite possibly, Romay. Either that, or it was just through default and his sense of smell led him to it. But it certainly is plausible. And Romay, I hope all is well in San Diego. I've never been there, maybe one day I'll come and visit. I haven't done much traveling in the States, and I think it's about time I rectify that. What would be nice is to take a couple of months off and do a road trip through your massive country. Another question through, this one's from Minneapolis, and Elizabeth would like to know, is it just her, or does it seem that Shadow has quite an irritable personality? And Elizabeth, I think, depending on which shows you've watched, it may just have been unfortunate that you have only seen her snarling and acting a bit grumpy. But I personally don't think she's irritable at all. She's very accommodating of us. Not at all nervous of the vehicle. She has not ever snarled once at us. But like I say, over the last few weeks, she has been displaying a little bit of aggression towards Sindile. But it's necessary to start kind of easing him into the fact that soon he is going to be alone, and she is going to be a lot less tolerant of him. Rather that than all of a sudden, just one day, out of the blue, she turns on him without any warning. I think she's kind of slowly teaching him that even though she is his mother, there is going to come a point in time where he's going to have to man up and start looking after himself. So I think her behavior so far has been fairly normal. But I certainly do see where you're coming from, Elizabeth. She does appear to contradict herself somewhat. Morning, Doug. How are you, buddy? How's it, Paul? All good. Okay, cool. No worries. Have a good one. Sorry, I just had to say hello to Doug there. He came into the sighting and he was busy doing his job, enlightening his guests as to what's going on, and I was busy chatting with you, and by the time he decided to leave, I hadn't even given him a thumbs up. So I just wanted to say hello to him quickly. Oh, hello, boy. Thanks for coming out into a nice clear spot. You are absolutely flawless, and there are going to be many, many people all around the world that are ecstatic that you've come out of your bushy breakfast spots. Now take a closer look. You can see a few tiny little spots above his whisker line, and he's got a perfect 3-3 spot pattern. On the left hand side of his muzzle, two of the spots are almost joined, but I think we can call them individual spots. It depends on the individual though. So if you look just to the right of his nostril, you'll see one dot and then two dots joined together. And then on the other side, he's just turned perfectly, you'll see three more individual spots. And it's usually, well, it's always from right to left that you'll call in a leopard spot pattern. And I think it's fair to say that he's got a, oof, it's tricky. I guess this is going to have to be up for debate. Is it 3-2 or 3-3? Because even though on his left muzzle, they are kind of two different spots that are joined, it's essentially one spot. But that is one way that you can identify a different leopard. Some leopards will have
a very similar or same spot pattern, be it 2-2 or 3-3 or 4-4 or 4-3, I mean, there's countless variables. And then you can look elsewhere on the leopard for other identifying features like notches in their ears, anything like that. Now, another question's come through from New York. So a lot of Americans are sending through the questions. If any of you are on the other end of the planet, feel free to get your country onto the map. And Claire would like to know, how did Shadow end up with the name? Because usually the leopards have got African names. And I guess it all depends on which leopards you're used to and which areas you may have been to, Claire. But I've noticed quite a few leopards actually have English names. It all depends on the individual lodge and actually the person who gets to name the leopard. So usually how it works now, it depends on where you are. But here, the guide and tracker who find the leopard cub for the first time are the ones that get to name it. And they are given kind of free rein, I guess, as to what name they would like to use. And I even believe Shadow was initially called Tundi, possibly. She had another name before it became Shadow. And even young Sindile, we as Safari Live have named, has not been officially named yet by the guides of this area. They're usually named when they become independent. And basically, a little bit of behind the scenes politics here, he was actually officially named as Madiba, but some of the guides from the surrounding lodges weren't happy with that name or the whole process that unfolded, so that now he's gone back to Shadow's cub just to keep the peace. So there's often a lot of politics and backwards and forwards with naming of animals, and it doesn't necessarily have to be African. It can be something related to their personality traits, whether they're angry or whether they move big distances or whether they're friendly. So there's many different names that can be used regarding their personality traits. Another very commonly used name is to be named after a certain area. So if this male was spending time along a certain road, be it this road, for example, that we're off now, called Second Windmill, he could be called the Second Windmill Male. And I mean, in this area, I can think of a few other leopards that also have not African names. There's the Anderson Male. Who else is there that I'm not thinking of? But yes, I guess you're right, Claire. Mostly African names, but a lot of those might be named after a road. And there's no conclusive final answer as to what they should be named or why. Another interesting question, and it's a good question that's come through from Tamara in Nebraska. And thanks for asking this because I haven't touched on it. Do young male leopards form coalitions with other young male leopards when they head out of their territory on their own, similar to cheetahs and lions? And no, Tamara, cheetahs are quite unique in that they do form coalitions, as they are also technically solitary animals. The females are always solitary. Leopards, though, are entirely solitary. The only time you will see leopards together is mother with young, or mother father mating for 3 to 5 days, or mother with father having an easy meal that mom has made. So sadly, he is going to be on his own. Well, not sadly, because that is what leopards do. But cheetah and lion are the only other cats that I know of that do form coalitions. Now, earlier I was talking about how lucky we are to be so close to these animals. And Monique in London, so thanks for putting the UK on the map in this sighting with questions. And she's only been watching for a few weeks. And she would like to know, do you have a minimum distance that you must maintain from the animals so as to not to disturb them? Is there any sort of law or regulation on that? And good point. In the Sabi Sands, it's up to the guide's discretion with how close you get to the animals. And I think that's the way it should be kept. There are so many variables within sightings and within individual animals that may allow you or disallow you to get close or have to remain far away, to leave a sighting when it's kind of getting dark, or whether you think it's okay to use a spotlight on a slightly young animal. I think the best thing is to use discretion, because there's so many variables. The wind in itself is a massive variable. If the wind was howling now and it was darkness, I would not be anywhere as close as I am to these leopards because of the risk of a hyena approaching and stealing their kill. Now, the reason why the wind is important and darkness is important is that it's obviously not as easy to see after dark, even though they have nocturnal vision. But also in a very, very strong wind, when there'd be a lot of ambient noise, that would mean the hyena's footsteps would be muffled as it approached. So I would try and position myself further enough away so that we weren't blocking the incoming hyena's view of the leopard, and vice versa. Whereas if it was a dead still evening, I'd be perfectly happy to sit here, because there'd be very little chance of anything creeping up to them. So that in itself is a good example of how the guide's discretion can be very valuable depending on the variables in the sighting. Also, obviously, you've got to take the specific animals into account. They've got no concern. As we drove up and reversed closer to Shadow, however, it must be said, at other camps and other lodges where you may go in Africa, they may have different rules. And I know at some camps where friends of mine have worked, there's, I think, a 25 meter limit to the animals. And obviously some people feel very strongly about that within those camps, and that's perfectly fine, but I don't think we're having any negative impact on these animals at the distance that we're at, and we are much closer than that. And at the end of the day, what we need to remember, Monique, is that in order for us to look after these animals, and in order for this animal, this area to be protected, it needs to gain revenue. And to gain revenue, we need to show people a good time when they are here. Now, obviously, we don't want it to do this at the expense of the animals, but there will be the ever so slight intrusion of us on their space, not intentionally, but simply to show people a good time. And by showing people a good time, more people keep coming to the Sabi Sands and will continue to protect this area and the animals within it for many, many years to come. So if by chance sometimes we may chase an impala away that they're trying to catch, or we may quite equally aid the leopard through default in helping catch an impala, it's never intentional. And that small impact that we do have is for the greater good of this area and the animals that live within it. Well, thank you very much for this update, Georgianne in Illinois, as well as Vancey in California. Shadow was originally named Tingana, which is her now boyfriend's name. And Tundi, another leopard which we don't get to see, which was Shadow's sister, I believe, was called Saseka. So the names change, and there's a bit of politics between the different guides and camps, and that's why these names do change. Also, even if it's not politics, sometimes I know with prides of lion, the Matimba male lions are called the Clarendon male lions on a certain property. And I personally think it would make more sense if everyone just agreed on any name. And for me personally, I don't think it makes a huge difference. I mean, obviously we wouldn't want to call this leopard Krusty the Clown, but I mean, any general name to differentiate one leopard from another is enough for me. And that way we can keep track of these individuals, and the people that get to view them can also know that this is their name and everyone would use it, but that would be in a perfect world. Well, I think Monique in London has got the UK audience more involved with the questions now, because we've got another one from Diana in Lancashire. Do leopards and other animals suffer from morning sickness if they are pregnant? Not that I've ever seen. So I'm certainly not aware of that, and I've only ever noticed all of the animals that are pregnant, both carnivore and herbivore, to carry on with business as normal. But a lot does go on out here without us seeing them, and I haven't spent huge amounts of times with pregnant animals, so maybe we've missed some signs of the morning sickness. And if any of you know of any interesting stories of wild animals showing morning sickness, please feel free to send us through those examples. And I can't express how grateful I am of all of the updates you send us out here. We've got another one from Elizabeth in Minneapolis, and she says Shadow and Tundi, the two sisters, one of which is right here, were in fact the first litter of Karula. I think there was a typer, a predict text typing area, and it's come through that they were Maryland's first litter, but I'm pretty sure it was Karula's first litter. Well, aren't we lucky that we got you just when we did? It was as things heated up, a little bit of movement, Shadow was feeding, and she did that really interesting call. Sandile came up, then she started growling at him. He kind of kept his distance, not knowing what to do. And then she slunk off, and he followed in behind her and managed to have a little snack. And now they're both lying up in perfect position for us to view them. And the questions are now spreading further west across the globe, from America to the UK and now to Amsterdam. And Petra would like to say, are there any updates on Kunyuma? She's one of our been following the show basically since it started up again in November last year. So seen on in Coral recently, so to the kind of south and west of us. He may well have slunk back onto Juma without us seeing him, but sadly there's a lot, like we've said, that goes on that we don't know about, and I'm sure it won't be long before we bump into him again. But if you would like to follow his progress, Petra, I would suggest either checking his Facebook page from time to time or the Coral Rangers, because they appear to be seeing quite a lot of him. Now, we're going to send you back to Jamie, who has got another apex predator waiting for you, and we'll be waiting here for you when you get back.
Sounds, by the sounds of it, I have a fresh kill. I really thought that by yesterday they would be done with that kill and they'd be moving on, but obviously they've decided that it's too good a feeding opportunity to pass up. But I'm sure the waterhole is a good place to be if you're a lion, especially if you're looking to eat something that isn't slightly rotten buffalo. Unfortunately for them, the position that they're at the dam is completely upwind of it. So, no, wait, hold on, downwind of it, sorry. Either way, their smell is going to be blowing straight towards any animals that come to drink, which is something that VM and I have just experienced as we switched positions. You can smell them quite strongly. It's not terrible, it's not like that buffalo from last night, but you can definitely smell lion and rotting meat. As you can imagine, for the lions, it must be very nice to, must be very nice to move to and from the dam, because they have access to really nice, fresh, clean water. Now, Gary, you were wondering how it is that lions can get by with so little water, and they definitely can. And although they will drink every day if they have the opportunity to, They're perfectly adapted for going a couple of days without water. And, you know, you see them in these desert areas around Botswana, and though their distribution, there might be slightly less of them around those areas, they survive perfectly happily. And the answer, I suppose, will lie with most desert dwelling or most water saving adaptations that mammals show, which would be within their kidneys, and they've got a way of preserving and reabsorbing the water that they use to help filter out all of that uric waste. So essentially, if we want to get really technical about it, they have probably have an extra long loop of Henle in their kidneys, which allows, it's basically just a tubule within the kidney that allows them to both filter out all of the urea that they need to get rid of, whereas, but also to spend a lot of time reabsorbing that water. So they don't waste as much water as we do during their metabolic processes, and they manage to keep it, most of it, in their bodies. And then of course with cooling down, they don't sweat like we do, although they do pant, so that can help cool them down. But they are just differently adapted to the way that we work. Now, I know that certain desert animals where it gets really, really hot, and I'm thinking in particular of the desert oryx, has a way of tricking the brain by sort of a countercurrent mechanism. So passing cooler blood that's been exposed to air around the hypothalamus in the brain that determines the temperature and the thermoregulation of the animal. And they use that as a way of tricking the brain into thinking the animal's body temperature is cooler than it actually is, so that they don't waste water trying to cool themselves down even more. Really very interesting. They're incredible animals. We've got this perfect view of these beautiful lionesses, and they really are very attractive girls. And Kathy, all the way from Tennessee, good morning and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. You were wondering if one of the lionesses has a darker face or whether it's just from being covered in a little bit of buffalo kill. And I'm thinking that you might be referring not to this female, but to the one at the back who's got her head kind of tucked down. And the times that I've seen her, yes, she does. She's still covered in the, how do I put this? Yes, there we go. She's lifted her head perfectly for us. Thanks, girl. She is very much covered in the internal organs and bits of buffalo carcass still. And that's probably what's carrying that scent so strongly across to us. It's interesting that she's been, the whole time, she's been the one who's spent the most amount of time feeding on that carcass. I can't offer you up an explanation for that, it's just an observation. I don't know, just in my opinion, the lioness I've seen feeding the most is the one that's now covered in buffalo, dead buffalo. But they are looking terribly peaceful. They both look equally well fed. Some very round bellies, not as round as that hyena who looked right on the verge of exploding. It was so full. These two seem pretty relaxed. I really wonder what their movements are going to be from here. Are they going to stick around and feed on that buffalo stall, even though it's now a couple of days old and probably quite even more rank than when we last saw it? Or are they going to move around and move south and start looking for the other members of their pride that are presumably with the Birmingham boys still? We still don't have any updates on that score. Now, the wind just blew a little gust of the scent towards us, and I was thrown right back to our experiences of last night, sitting next to the buffalo kill, And Sharon, who's all the way from Pittsburgh, good morning to you as well, and welcome to the Sunrise Safari. In terms of how I tolerate it without feeling nauseous, I have to confess, and I'm usually very good with smells and dead animals. I've seen a lot of them a couple of times. Last night was particularly extraordinary, and I definitely felt a little bit of nausea, I suppose. In fact, it wasn't even really that I was nauseous. It was honestly more like I just couldn't focus on anything else but the smell. And of course, every time I opened my mouth to breathe, to talk to you guys and to answer your questions, I got another sort of extra layer of it. And I think that carrying Vicks VapoRub, as you suggested, is probably a very good idea. Pop some up my nose and see if that helps at all. Andrew was tucked with his buff up above his nose, breathing through there, and he said even then he was still feeling the effects slightly. We were both a little bit green towards the end, and at that point when I said we were going to go and look at the other lioness who was lying down, it was honestly because I couldn't sit with them anymore. I just couldn't sit with that buffalo. I don't know what it was. I'm usually very good. I've seen lots of carcasses. I've dissected old carcasses before. There's something about that buffalo that was a special new level of stinky. Well, these lions seem perfectly at peace, and I don't think they're going to be up to terribly much this morning. I think we'll find them once again at the start of the sunset safari, somewhere in this drainage line probably, if they're not still here. The sun does tend to move and then their shade disappears here, and they duck down, if they follow the same pattern, they duck down into this drainage line. It has been a morning filled with rather full bellies, or looked like rather full bellies, to the point of exploding. And I apologize for our late start and delay, but we will be back up and running on the sunset safari this afternoon. Big thank you to Viam for all of his hard work, and I'm going to say goodbye to all of you guys and catch up with you this afternoon. We're going to head across to Scott for the last few moments of our sunrise safari. Cheers for now. Well, I said I was going to say goodbye for now, but we are still here. It seems as though Scott's signal issues have been following him all morning. Poor guy. So we're going to finish up our last few moments, possibly with me, possibly we might have a last glimpse of Shadow and Sindile. Oh, there we go. He is right back up, so let's end the show with those. Never mind, it's back down again. Nope, okay. Sorry, everybody. Unfortunately, we won't have the last view of Shadow and young Sinzile at their kill. And in that case, I'm going to say a big goodbye and a big thank you on behalf of Scott and Andrew, who are on Wendy, off in Arethusa and struggling with their signal issues. So goodbye from all of us at Wild Earth, and a big thank you to all of you, as well as the FC team and Eugene. And we will catch up with you for the Sunset Safari. And this time I'm actually going to say goodbye, and it will actually be the end of the show. Goodbye, everybody.